Hey, Robert.
Hey, Yaron.
So I'm in this weird lighting situation because I'm in a hotel room in London. So
The other side of the world.
the other side of the world. So it all looks a little weird, but I think we'll survive this. We both came across this article well, it's a manifesto, actually. It's a Techno-Optimist Manifesto. The other day, I think it was 2 days ago, and by Marc Andreessen, who is the founder of Andreessen Horowitz, who's a big time venture capitalist, incredibly successful venture capitalist. We've talked about venture capital quite a bit on in the context of Ingenuism. Anyway, he came out with this manifesto about techno optimism. And I think it struck us both as, wow, this is really cool and exciting and also an opportunity.
Absolutely. Although I can't believe you left out his original claim to fame was as an entrepreneur, launching the
That's right.
first web browser and then, some of the first cloud computer tools. So, before Marc Andreessen became an investor, he was an entrepreneur and, very successful, but also very insightful. Very early in two of the biggest trends of the last 50 years.
And of course they have a completely different approach, or at least had a completely different approach to venture capital early on. It's how they really got going. They invested heavily in kind of, or they invested a little bit in a lot of very young entrepreneurs that typically a lot of the other venture capital funds might have passed on because of inexperience. And they built some of one of the most successful incubators in the history of venture capital, and have been phenomenally successful at incubating these companies with relatively young first-time entrepreneurs. So he's been at the forefront of almost every kind of trend within Silicon Valley. And we talked about him recently because he's one of the few voices coming out of Silicon Valley that is really emphasizing the positive aspect of artificial intelligence when everybody else seems to be completely freaking out about the end of the world and about the Terminator movie is coming true. Marc Andreessen has actually spent a lot of time trying to point out the positives of the positive potential of artificial intelligence, and trying to get everybody to just calm down a little bit and consider the upside, not just the fantasy downside.
He is reliably and emphatically positive on the benefits of technology and progress, which, weirdly isn't always the case in Silicon Valley. Entrepreneurs tend to be very positive and emphatically in favor of whatever they're doing, but then there's, other stuff that maybe needs to have a different approach. Where Marc Andreessen staked out that this is how it should be for everything, for everybody, for all efforts, and it's refreshing because he's in a sense he's talking up his own book, but in a much more real sense he has a vision for humanity that is very much aligned with Ingenuism, and I think it makes the important point that Ingenuism isn't something out in left field. It's what in fact, in different forms, is either intuited or explicitly stated is behind successful organizations and successful individuals, and so it's nice to see someone take up the drumbeat for progress and with no apologies, and to recognize that if the alternative, and it's a slippery slope. I mean, in hypothetically, you could just tweak around the edges, but there is no evidence that government regulatory agencies tweak around the edges. That's just it's not how it generally goes. And so to recognize the opportunity cost of putting your foot on the brake and how that diverges the future we end up in from the future we could have ended up in, and the the massive human costs that are borne primarily by the less well off on the planet. We might not be as rich in 50 years. Our kids might not be as rich as in 50 years, but there are people who if we put our foot on the brake, there are people, and I'm talking about hundreds of millions, possibly billions of people who will be in poverty that could have been in material abundance.
Absolutely.
And Marc Andreessen finds that unacceptable, and we find it unacceptable. So it's very refreshing to see that.
And yeah, and it's hard to believe that that if you don't put your foot on the brakes, that we're not all better off, because I think we're all better off. It's not a zero sum that the poor are better off because we've slowed down. We're just all, and I think that the beauty of what Andreessen has written is it really is an ode to progress, to and recognizing the role of technology in progress, and it's an ode to abundance. I mean, he's big on this idea that abundance is an amazing thing. I think it's amazing to read, and it's a little scary that it's amazing to read, because you'd think that this would be just a common attitude, particularly of people involved in technology, but the common attitude of the culture more broadly, because we're all the massive beneficiaries of technological progress, of growth, economic growth, of abundance. And you have to say that if you're middle class and above in America today, with regard to a lot of things, there is abundance. And, you know, just go into the grocery store and see the choices that you have. That's the definition of abundance. It doesn't mean it's free. It just means that plenty of choices and people can afford them. So this should be kind of the thing that everybody holds. It's sad in a sense that you need somebody like Andreessen to remind us and make such a forceful attempt at it. And I think part of what is missing from Andreessen is kind of an Ingenuism framework, is understanding, okay, but why? What actually makes all this possible? What drives technological progress, abundance, growth, and all of those things? I mean, he comes very close, but he doesn't quite have a model for what is actually generating it.
And that's what Ingenuism is. You know, we started talking about it to provide that framework, mm-hmm. because Marc Andreessen, among, you know, lots of successful entrepreneurs and investors, intuits that these things are incredibly important, and basically makes the assertion that these are incredibly important, regardless of, you know, what problems you're trying to solve, that technology is the solution. And I agree, but it is one step removed from what we would say is really going on, which is that not only do you have to create an environment where people are nurtured to tap their ingenuity and start creating new ideas and new insights and new technologies. And for him, I like the way he defines technology as both ideas and tools. Which is the right way to do it. People think of technology, it's like, oh, the iPhone, this is technology. But technology comes in a lot of different flavors and accomplishes a lot of different things. But in addition to having that sort of environment, the level of connection that we have in the world is also incredibly important. And, you know, it might be that it's time to start thinking about Ingenuism 2.0, because when we started this, the idea was, you know, there are certain rules that you can't violate if you want to be effective and have progress in the world, regardless of what your goals are. And they're violated all the time. And they're violated primarily and in the worst ways at the top, you know, mm-hmm. by central authorities. And so let's just make the point that this is a bad way of doing it. And of course, it has no impact because it involves the central authorities, you know, decentralizing authority. And the way might be that you just get everyone thinking like Marc Andreessen. And to do that, it has to be more than just I intuit that technology is the answer. Because unfortunately, there are a lot of people who intuit that technology is the problem. And so if you take a step back and you say ingenuity is the answer, and what you're thinking about technology is only one way to think about it, and how do we foster ingenuity? How do we give people an environment that they, or allow them to develop an environment where they are able to tap into something that is a natural part of the human condition? If everyone was an ingenuist, we wouldn't be, you know, in awe of Marc Andreessen's. Well, so we'd be like, oh, here's another
I mean, there'd be very few problems in the world, I suspect, if everybody was that. The challenge is, how do we get to that point? And part of it is educate people about these benefits and realizations. But sadly, there are lots of ideologies out there that kind of clash with even the goals of human flourishing and human success. So, you know, it's part of the world in which we live, and we have to deal with it, and we have to make the most of the better people that we have. And that's part of why it's so encouraging to see Marc Andreessen do this.
Yes, because, you know, if you have 1,000 Marc Andreessens talking to 1,000,000 people, then it's not long before the general attitude starts to change. And then that's where you actually would see movement in the worst offenders, you know, at the top in the political system. Until then, you know, it's probably moot. But that in itself is, you know, a very ingenuous way of looking at it. I mean, our original thought, if we can impact the top, well, that would be very effective hypothetically, but in practice, that's just not how things are done. You know, Ingenuism, techno-optimism, these are things that are going to end up spreading virally. They're going to end up taking over the world because they are the answer. But it requires that they spread sort of person to person.
Yes, absolutely. And people who are interested, I mean, you can look at a16z.com, or you just Google techno-optimism and Andreessen Horowitz or Marc Andreessen, and you can find the article. I encourage people to share it and get it out there. It's very non-political. He really is making an effort not to offend anybody, and really just focus on what I think we agree on, non-controversial issues around human prosperity, human growth, and the real effects of technology and the real impacts that they have. And I think the more people engage with this, the better off it is. And yeah, in the end, the people at the top are somewhat a reflection of the culture that we have at the bottom. If we can change the culture at the bottom, the people at the top will change. That's the only way they can get elected. And they change. So the effort really is education, education, education. And look, the funny thing is that not that long ago, this was the culture. I mean, I don't think it's far-fetched to say that as even, you know, we were hanging out in the 90s in Silicon Valley, there was much more of this. There was much more of a techno-optimistic attitude. And some things, unfortunately, happened in the last 20 years to change that. But this was the dominant, I think, view back then. And it's kind of sad to have shifted away from it.
I think, you know, I definitely think it's sad, but I think it's also incredibly costly and damaging.
Yep.
I mean, you said a few minutes ago, you know, if everyone thought like Marc Andreessen, we wouldn't have a lot of problems. And I'm going to say we would have a lot of problems, but they would be much, much better problems. They would be problems of how do we farm on Mars, or how do we mine the asteroids, where it's not a hypothetical question.
Challenges, not problems, I guess.
Exactly. The difference, that's a great way to put it, because the difference between a challenge and a problem, we often collapse them, but there's a really important difference, because problems are something that you solve in order to have something not happen, mm-hmm. where a challenge is something you solve in order to have something happen and get a positive result, not to avoid a negative result.
Yep.
And that shift in focus from challenges to problems, and every problem can be reconstructed as a challenge, which is, what is it not that I don't want to avoid, but what do I want to have instead of whatever I have now? But that's less and less how people think about things. You know, climate change is controversial, so it's dangerous to talk about in a if you're trying to make a blanket statement that appeals to everybody. But the reality is that climate change is posed as a problem, and as a problem, it calls for certain solutions versus climate change as a challenge. Or let's say, you know, I think it's not controversial to say that the globe has warmed, mm-hmm. without getting into the reasons and the results of that. Okay, well, what do we want? What is it that we want? Do we want it to stop warming? Do we want it to be a degree cooler? Do we want it to be a degree? And that becomes a challenge and something that I think is actually, from a technology perspective, it would not be difficult to solve, and probably not that expensive if you start opening yourself up to, okay, how do we get what we want? Now, how do we avoid what we think we're going to get?
And the beauty is that you exact once you frame it as a challenge, you get ingenuism activated in a sense, right? So you get ingenuity, right? Problems are hindrances that what you can't do, blockades, and challenges are open-ended. Okay, well, let's find a solution. And this is where ingenuity comes in. This is where individual initiative comes in. This is where connection comes in, because if we face a challenge, we can solve it, as together, as in teams, and we can figure this out. So, and knowledge that is developed far, far away, you can access very, very quickly today. So ingenuity really kicks in, ingenuism really kicks in when you start framing everything as a challenge, and that's where solution comes from.
Yeah, that itself would be, it goes on the list of, how do we, what do we change about how we develop ourselves and particularly young people inside of schooling and outside of schooling? Just, we talk all about problems throughout school. And it's a certain type of problem that is defined differently. It's a well-specified, here, solve this problem. But it just starts this that drip of driving the attention to don't get the wrong answer as opposed to what can you actually learn.
Yeah, and it's orienting people towards positive values, orienting people towards achieving something, some positive outcome, is a really important mindset to have. Human flourishing or economic growth, depending on the context in which you think about it, once you frame things in those terms, there's a lot of ideas out there. There's a lot of people who can bring their ingenuity to the issues and the challenges.
That raises
It
something I
becomes
wanted
exciting.
to bring up because in the manifesto, and this is a good example of where I think applying ingenuism has value if you're trying to appeal to the world as opposed to a tribe. There's a stated belief about a universal basic income, and it's one that I don't know if you saw it, but it's one that I think you would completely agree with philosophically, that basically with a universal basic income, people become, they're now farmed by the government, and that's not what a techno-optimist believes. And I think that's probably exactly what you believe. And it's something I'm sympathetic to. And it's something that a lot of people would viscerally reject. And if you start from the lens of ingenuism and you say, okay, well, let's think about a universal basic income. Is it going to increase connection? Is it going to increase learning? How is it going to impact ingenuity? And given that ingenuity is the intersection of curiosity and ambition, how is it going to impact curiosity and ambition? And you could argue both ways. I think we would lean towards it's going to suppress ambition more than it elevates curiosity, and that effect is going to be negative. And you'd say, okay, well, we want to be careful because this could be a significant negative from the perspective of progress with ingenuism. And then you go out and say, okay, well, we could be wrong, so let's do some small experiments and let's gather the data we need to be able to figure out, is there something here? Is there some universal principle that positive or negative? Is there some mixed principle where in certain situations it's a huge win and in other situations it's a huge loss? But actually discover what the result would be from a universal basic income. But instead, what we typically get are people who either say, no, that's crazy. We don't believe in that kind of stuff. You see people are saying, yes, this is clearly necessary for human dignity. And I don't want to argue against human dignity. I want to just test that hypothesis that it really is something that's going to benefit, because I'm very skeptical.
Yeah, I am too, but I also am skeptical of, I think it's very, these are the kind of things that are very difficult to test. I mean, because there have been some tests, but they're always going to be critics, because it's, you know, some people are going to bet, there's no question that for some people, this will be increased curiosity more than, but what does an average mean? How do we measure that? I mean, it's very complex. And there's a sense in which, as an ingenuous one, wants to step even one step back from that and say, what is the problem we're trying to solve? So there are people who don't make enough money, there are people who are below the poverty line, or something like that. What is the, how do we solve that problem? UBI being one of many potential solutions. And so I'd like to step even further back and say, okay, what is the problem? And, or what is the challenge? There we go. What is the challenge? And how do we solve this challenge? And I have a feeling they're more optimal solutions that are more consistent with this kind of techno-optimistic view of the world that we could come up with that maybe are not as quite as universal you know, we're making the assumption that people behave in a particular way that are not quite universal in those kind of assumptions.
I think that we completely agree and are talking about slightly different things. Yep. Because there's the question of how can we make people better off individually? You know, if they're, mm-hmm. if they're poor, you know, what is it that would benefit them? And then you can, you know, the market section of Andreessen's manifesto, I think, is really solid at making the point, maybe overly redundant, because the point is that markets work, and markets have worked to create abundance even for the poor in the United States. And you know, one way you get the equivalent of a universal basic income is you let technology make energy free. That you the marginal cost of physical goods approaches zero with energy being free. And so you don't need an income, because it's every or much of an income. But what I was more looking at is the question of, would a universal basic income make the world a better place? And if it did, what would it look like? Because people have a vision of, oh, a universal basic income is this. And it's even the name, universal basic income. So it seems very well defined. But I don't think anyone really means universal. And if you do, then is it also include 1-year-olds, 10-year-olds, fetuses?
Yep.
And how big is it? And like, what does basic mean? And what is income? Is it cash? Is it income? But those questions are detailed tactics. The strategy would be, you know, look, does this abundance is making the world a better place. And one of the reasons is because people have more time to spend indulging their ingenuity. Mm-hmm. They're not just trying to survive.
Yep.
And so would this make the world a better place? Now, I don't think it's this big lever that you would pull first in terms of trying to make the world a better place, but it is an example of something that easily devolves into tribes. And it, from the lens of ingenuism, you can immediately see why that is, because it's not clear cut if you think about it in terms of curiosity and ambition, but it is testable. And I agree it would be difficult, and people would use their tribal instincts to try and interpret whatever results you got in their favor. But there would be a way to start answering the question, does a universal basic income make the world a better place?
Yep.
But nobody's Good. Talking about doing that. People are talking about how do we get there? It's like Obamacare. How do we get what we really want by getting there in stages versus can we figure out if this is something that is actually going to make the world a better place?
Yeah. And is the end result that we're striving towards, is that going to make the world a better place? So this is a, you know, because this is a step in a particular direction. Is the direction a good direction from the perspective of making the world a better place?
Right. And when you have it's centralized decision making, it's always how do we get the first step so we can get momentum so that we can get there regardless of what we learn along the way, not based on what we learn along the way. But that's why we need 350 million ingenuists in the United States. And then
absolutely
the world?
Well, I mean, good for Andreessen. This is, I think, a valuable article or manifesto. I think people are going to be inspired by it. I hope a lot of people sign up for it. And he has a kind of a reading list at the bottom, at least, of authors that he suggests reading, which is useful. But and I think the other thing about if people go and read this, it's nicely written. It's kind of written in a pretty style that anybody, I think, can understand. It's pithy, but still making an argument and presenting an argument. So I'm overwhelmingly positive about this development. This is good.
Yep, techno optimists.
There you go.